So please join me in welcoming Ned Martin.
Good morning. Thank you. I sat next to an old man on a bench at a picnic table, and we watched as children ran around and laughed and played. And I frankly don't remember who that old man was, and I really don't remember the exact question I asked of him, but my question started something like, why does? And he looked down at me and he said, because Y is a crooked letter. I never liked that answer. As many years has passed by, I still don't like that answer. But over time, I've become accustomed or comfortable with the idea that not all Ys and Hows belong to us. And that concept certainly has its place in the world of art, and it has its place in the creative process itself. You can't use a measuring tape or calipers to measure the creative process or creativity. And I know there are a lot of studies out there, and there's a lot of science going on trying to understand the brain and neuropathways, but I promise you that even in today's times, the science versus understanding the hows and whys of the creative process are miles and miles apart. Creative logic is an oxymoron. So why and how does the creative process work? The one thing that we know for absolutely sure is that we don't know. Why do we get our best ideas in the shower? We don't really understand that, but it has something to do with not using that linear side of your brain and tapping into the emotional side. The good news is that we can use the creative process even though we don't know how it works. I don't know how electricity works, but I can use it. I can plug my iPhone into a wall socket and get results. And the creative process is much the same. I can plug in and I can get results. Another important thing to remember about the creative process is that it's a skill set. That is, the more you use it correctly, the better you get at it. I know that because I've been using the creative process all my life, and I've been able to now tap into it very quickly and get results from it. I began drawing and painting from childhood, and art was the one thing that I was good at. So rewards beget devotion. Devotion begets skills, and then passion snuck up on me like the girl in your math class that you never noticed, and suddenly you're madly in love with her and you can't live without her for the rest of your life. And the moment that I no longer was in control, the moment I had to follow my passion, I became an artist. I was born in Pennsylvania. I spent most of my life in Northern Maryland, close to the Pennsylvania line, and then moved to New York. And then about 5 years ago, I met my wife, Renee, and came full circle by spending half of my time in PA and half of my time in New York. So I felt at home here in this rural setting, and I spent many, many hours in the local fields and woods searching for paintings. My creative process at that time was all about finding light and textures and mood and color. I not only fell in love with Renee and her family, but also the community of people here in the land itself. There was, I thought, an endless wealth of inspiration here in Pennsylvania, an endless supply of paintings that begged to be produced. Then, on February 17th of last year, Renee and I were grooming our horses not far from here on the Eck family farm in the Nepenthe Valley. And she was holding both ropes as I brushed. The horses spooked, one rope let go, the other formed a tangle, and she was dragged and hit a tree. When the paramedics arrived, I backed away to let them do their job. I crossed the field to put the horses back into their stalls, and then started back across the field again and walked towards the ambulance. What happened at that moment is very difficult to put into words. Months actually went by before I could process any of it. After a time, I began to realize that her heart had stopped beating as they were putting her into the ambulance. And at that instant, an intense energy engulfed me and took me to a place of profound beauty and light and love. I think sometimes that she was trying to take me with her, and they explained to her that was not a good idea, so she let go and I came back. From that time on, I simply do not see things in the same way. My creative process now is completely different. Now paintings come to me from within and present themselves as hungry children vying for attention. And there are so many that I fret in my proliferation. The outward search for paintings, for now at least, has ceased. But when I do attempt to look outward, it's the images scrambled, and I try to make the sense of the simplest things, and my imagery is much like a bad signal. There was actually a period of time following Renee's death that I simply could not paint, and painting realism was a reflection or an expression of my reality, and my reality was something that I wanted to run and hide from. Then the sultry mistress of abstract painting wooed me with false promises. She convinced me that I could paint again, and it could be just mechanical, or no emotions attached, no feelings. And in my emotionally drunken state, I strayed. Oh, but that vixen had lied to me. Unlike realism, abstraction has very, very few boundaries. Within a world of painting nothing, you are simultaneously painting everything. I had been pulled from my relatively safe haven of realism, where there are parameters set, where emotional hand-holding abounds. In realism, with its inherent use of subject matter, light, textures, mood, the viewer is actually guided to feel and react. Certain emotional buttons are pushed, others are completely eliminated. When I began painting within the abstract genre, I found I could indeed feel nothing, but I could also feel everything and anything. The more I resisted feeling, the more entangled I became in my own emotions. I thrashed around and struggled, got myself into a frayed ball of knots bound tight in my own fears and sadness. Finally, I accepted that my emotions were actually the very raw fuel of creativity itself. Now I know the pain, the joy, the laughter, and tears are extremely powerful gifts. And to refute those emotions would be a bigger tragedy still. When I summon enough courage to express my emotions with paint, it has the power to transport me to the far reaches of this universe. And most importantly to me, when I embrace and use my emotions in my creative process, I honor my Renee. So I feel. So I paint. Someone recently asked me in an interview if there was a message that I wanted people to walk away with from this show. And I replied that I would not answer that question normally, because I've always believed that interpretation belongs solely to the viewer. Who am I then to tell you how you should feel or what you should see in my art? However, these are not normal times, and so I feel compelled to verbalize that first, I am aware of this exhibit's morose side. Death is at its core. Yet, I beg you to see, for if you look more closely, the exhibit is also about a journey and how it affects the creative process. This exhibit is conveniently divided into before the video and after, but it's not as simple as that. The process transmutes through time. For example, when the anniversary of Renee's death came around this year, I asked my sons and daughter-in-laws to be with me. I was explaining to Scott that I needed them. I wanted them to share the day, and I needed Ned and Taylor and Scott and Greer around me, and I needed me. And then Scott interrupted me and said, "Well, Dad, you're not the only one who lost Renee." Profoundly true. It didn't feel that way up to that point. Grief and sadness are very myopic. But I know many lost Renee on all kinds of levels, and we lose people who are near and dear to us. A loss changes us. And as an artist, it can change the creative process completely. So I do hope that you walk away from this exhibit with a new perspective of how we all move on, because we have no other choice. And the other side of this message is one of beauty and hope, adoration and love. I want to close with an announcement, because I cannot think of a better example of moving on than new life itself. And I'm extremely happy to announce today that Scott and Greer are going to have a baby. A new life is coming into this world in December. And if there's one thing Renee loved more than dogs and cats, horses and critters, it was babies. So The next time you hear a thunder or the next time you witness a rumbling in the sky, I want you to know that it's okay. It's just Renee jumping up and down up there from sheer joy over her first grandchild. Thank you so much. Love you all.